Emergency power prep. It's one of those things that most people think they've nailed until the power goes out. And then you find out at the absolute worst time, the mistakes that you've made. It's happened to all of us, it's happened to me. So today we're gonna try to break down the top mistakes that we see people make and how you guys can avoid them. So welcome back to the lab where our opinions cannot be bought. Not only are we all about giving you guys honest reviews and feedback on products, but we like to help you guys avoid mistakes where we can so that you don't waste your hard-earned money. And this video is actually part of a home backup course that Anker Solix created. If you guys are interested in checking out the whole course, there's a link in the description down below. There's some other helpful videos on there related to emergency backup power for you guys as well. But for the sake of this video, let's jump into the top four mistakes that we see people making when they're trying to build an emergency backup kit. The first mistake is relying on one big battery. Big batteries are tempting. Often they feel like a one and done solution. They're usually a better bang for your buck. And honestly, on the channel, we've recommended some pretty big batteries before. The issue with that is a couple of things. The first one being, what happens if that battery for some reason fails to charge? Or maybe that battery just went down due to age or cycling issues. In that case, you have nothing else. There's no redundancy and there's no plan B. And in the case of an emergency situation, how you can actually charge that battery at that time is often very limited. So if you got storm clouds blocking the sun, the storm has done damage to your actual solar array, or the grid is just down, now you're still stuck in the dark, which is the exact problem that you were trying to avoid in the first place. That's not a backup plan, that's a bottleneck. There's also the possibility that maybe nothing went wrong. The outage that you're experiencing is just way longer than you expected it to be. This happened to us last winter. We had a storm come through and the outage was longer than anything that we had ever seen. And sometimes you just get caught off guard. So what's the solution here? One solution would be to have multiple smaller batteries to avoid that first situation. If you have a very large system, you could have multiple large batteries. But if you have a medium-sized system, instead of getting one big battery, maybe a couple of server rack batteries might actually be better in this situation. Not only does this give you the flexibility to where if you have an issue with one of your batteries, you still have other batteries to rely on, but if you're kind of getting low on that power situation, you can actually take one battery and charge it with whatever way you can come up with while the other one is still running your system. We actually frequently recommend that you guys get a gas generator, but not necessarily to be used the way that you would think. You can actually get a small gas generator and use it to charge your batteries and just have basically a battery backup system. So in the case of the storm tore through and it's lasting way longer than you thought, or your panels are down and there's no grid power, you're running out of juice in your batteries, running a generator for an hour or two is usually enough to fill those batteries back up. So you're not using it in the traditional way where it's just outside humming all day long, making noise, using gas, being annoying. You're using it in the way of just topping up the system you already have for a couple hours per day and then running in silence like you expect it to for the rest of the time. Saves you a bunch of money on gas, and it's also just a lot quieter and just nicer to be around. Second mistake is overestimating solar panel performance. Solar is amazing, but it's not magic, and the specs that you guys see on the listing for panels are often in perfect lab conditions. The right angle to the sun, the right temperature, no clouds, no shade, full sun conditions. Real life is not always like this. You might have an off-season sun angle, a slightly cloudy day. Sometimes a 400 watt panel will be producing 100 watts if you're lucky. To fix this, you have basically two options. The first one is to oversize your system. A lot of companies actually recommend that you get a bigger solar array than what an inverter can take. So a lot of times a company will say, get a 21 kilowatt solar array, and their inverter only accepts 18 kilowatts of solar because they're accounting for that loss in power that you're gonna get even on an almost perfect day. Option two is always have some sort of backup alternative, whether that's AC wall charging if you're expecting to be able to have grid power, or even a small dual fuel generator like we mentioned before. Solar should be part of the plan, but it shouldn't be the only plan. A lot of times when you have a storm coming, the conditions before that storm actually arrives aren't the best. You're probably gonna have clouds, you're probably gonna have things that make your panels generate a lot less power. So even if you can simply plug your system into the grid and charge those batteries with AC power in preparation for the storm, that's a backup plan. As long as you have somewhat of a notice that that storm is coming, you can usually get away with doing something as simple as that. Third mistake is ignoring starting watts or surging power of your devices. So surge power or starting watts, the easiest way to think of this is like riding a bike. When you get on a bike, the first couple pedals are always the hardest as you get it moving. Once you're moving, it's kind of easy and you're just pedaling, cruising, having a good time. Lots of appliances and devices that you're gonna run do the exact same thing. Like an air conditioner, for example, when you first start that up, it takes a big surge of power to get the fans moving and everything going. But once it's moving, the power kind of dwindles back down and you're good to go. This giant compressor takes 10,000 watts just to start. But once it's running, it barely hits 3,000 watts just to keep it going. That quick surge is often enough to trip your inverter or overload your power station. Same thing goes for something like a well pump or a vacuum. People often size their systems based on running watts. They forget to account for the surge or starting watts, and then they realize that they can't turn the vacuum on while the air conditioner is running because it'll surge over the limitation of their unit. The solution to this would be to try your best to find out the surging capacity of your device. Not everything is always listed. Call a brand or a store that you trust and ask them, and they'll be able to give you a general idea. Heck, Google can mostly give you a general idea of surging of your specific devices. You can also just get the biggest inverter that you can afford at the time. And we would always recommend this because if you're saying you're gonna run an average of 2000 watts, you don't wanna get a 2000 watt inverter because that leaves you no room to grow. So if you can afford to, it's always better to get the biggest inverter that you can at that time. Not only will that give you a ton more surge capacity, it'll also allow you to, in that emergency situation, run things that you maybe didn't account for or you weren't planning on running without tripping your system. And the fourth and final mistake is forgetting the little stuff. You got your gear, your panels, batteries, inverters, or power station, but where's your extension cable, your adapter cables, your fuel, or your random little MC3 adapter cable that you didn't know you needed? We've seen setups totally fail because one tiny adapter cable or piece was missing, and the worst time to find that out is in the middle of an outage. And the fix for this might sound redundant, but trust us, more people need to be doing this, is doing a full dry run of your system before a storm comes. Get it set up, get everything hooked up, running and functioning the way you want it to in case of an emergency coming through. Don't just have your stuff in a box in the corner or 90% finished and you'll just touch it up right before the storm comes, because even if you do it a day or 3 days before that storm comes, you might not have time to ship that little thing that you need. And now you're out all the money and you're still sitting in the dark. See what's missing now, not later, and make a checklist while you're at it of anything that might also be even just nice to add. So look, if you've made any of these mistakes, or even if you think these mistakes are simple and you wouldn't have made them, a lot of people do, and the good news is hopefully now you know better. That just means that you can prep a little bit smarter and hopefully actually be ready for when the lights go out. So hopefully this was helpful to you guys. Make sure you check out Anker Solix's official website, check out their full course. At the end of that course, there's a little quiz you can take and you actually get entered to win some free stuff. As always, we have links in the description down below to any discount codes that we can get you guys to save you guys some money if you're in the market, as well as information on this month's giveaway. So make sure you guys check that out. Anyways, that's all we got for you guys today. Thank you so much for watching. Peace out and stay charged.